We're going to watch The Strange Case of the Cosmic Rays. Let's press play.
Want to see an out-of-this-world true detective story? Well, sharpen your wits and hop on your magic carpet. You've got one, you know. Your imagination.
Eddie Albert is not in this one. Dr. Research's co-star is Richard Carlson, who was in It Came From Outer Space and also Creature from the Black Lagoon.
Phantom invaders from outer space, master keys to nuclear magic, adventure, discovery, the greatest 50 years in the history of mankind. But how do we package all that into a show?
It's very simple. We ask your magic screen.
I have, but when it's blank up here, it's blank up...
The magic screen.
I'll turn off one light and we'll
maybe it isn't so blank up here. Come on, magic screen, come up with something.
Here we are back in mystery land, ladies and gentlemen and men. Oh man, have we got excitement. Great night, great night. Everybody's got a detective story candidate. Agatha Christie, Earl Stanley Gardner, Dorothy Sayers. Everybody's got a candidate as the crowd mills around the famous Academy of Detection Arts and Sciences. And no wonder. Being voted on tonight is the award. The Edgar, it's called, for the best detective story of the first half of the 20th century.
Best detective story?
Ed, any word from the judges yet? Take it away, Ed.
I can just barely see the judges. Boy, are they sweating. There they are.
This is an absolute bore. Are these writers?
Mystery schmystery. On the first page, I know who did it. who done it.
You all recognize the chairman, Edgar Allan Poe, whose murders in the Rue Morgue won the first Edgar.
Nevermore.
To his right, Charles Dickens, who gave us one of the strangest detective stories ever penned. The Unfinished Mystery of Edwin Drood. And on the chairman's left is Fyodor Mikhailovich Dostoevsky. And that golden skull you see on the table, that's the winner's prize, the coveted Edgar.
Of course. That's it. That's us. Gentlemen.
What are you doing?
Most honorable judges, we have an entry for you.
Another entry?
What's he talking about?
The contest is closed.
Well, how can it be when we've got the greatest detective story of the last 50 years? The Strange Case of the Cosmic Rays.
Cosmic Rays.
Strange Case of the Cosmic Rays. An excellent title.
You realize, of course, the detective story has certain requirements.
Analysis, deduction, seemingly insignificant clues.
That's right.
Well, our story begins with a clue so insignificant, Mr. Poe, it wasn't even noticed for 100 years or more.
The detective story is literature. It must have scope.
Scope, he says. Jim, roll 3. Why, the cosmic ray case has helped to revolutionize the modern world. Look, have a look. Atomic power plants for the future. Atomic subs. Atomic planes. Radioactive drugstores. Isotopes for medicine. And hold on to your hats. How's that for scope? Well, gentlemen, do we qualify?
Theodore?
Yet. Science is for me a big bore.
A big bore? Why, do you realize that just while you were speaking, the criminal in our case fired 20 atomic bullets through your head?
Good. Holes in the head I like.
And you traced this criminal through that tiny clue you spoke of?
Yes, the story begins as an ordinary theft. Theft from this simple electroscope, a common instrument that's been in use to detect radiation for generations. It's just an airtight jar with an insulated metal rod, from one end of which hang 2 pieces of gold leaf. Now, normally, they hang straight down. Thank you, boy. But as every school kid knows, when an electric charge is put on the rod, so the leaves become charged. Now, as to the detection powers of the electroscope. When radiation is from this piece of uranium, for instance, enters the jar, the air inside is broken up into charged fragments, some of which neutralize the charge on the leaves and cause them to fall. And the stronger the radiation, the faster they fall.
What is this, a schoolroom? Where is the mystery?
Well, the mystery is that when a charged electroscope was put aside, when no known radiation was around, the gold leaves mysteriously lost their charge and collapsed anyway.
The tiny clue. So, is leaking a little electricity. That's a bank robbery?
That's just how science thought of it. Bank robbery. Roll four. Now, imagine the charged electroscope as a kind of bank and the known radiations as thieves, bank robbers. Yeah, there you are. Depositors putting their hard-earned electrons into savings accounts. Wait a minute. That's no depositor there. That's Miss Ultraviolet Ray. She's one of the slyest of our robbers. Lift the electrons right off your back.
Drop up and have a jolt sometime.
Don't you do it. There's a distant cousin of Violet's over there, Gamma Ray. Ordinary walls don't mean a thing to him. Wow, here comes a real tough bunch in from the hideout. The Uranium Gang. Those hombres have been in and out of the calaboose so often they go by numbers. 234, 235, and 238. I hope 235's not carrying what I think he is. You know, those boys are the Atom Bomb Boys.
Help! 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 Sheriff! Robbery! Help! They went that away!
Put on more guards! This thievery has got to stop! Rebuild the bank. Put lead walls around it, 9 feet thick.
So with 9 feet around it, the electroscope bank became the Fort Knox of science. Not one of our robbers was sly enough like Ultraviolet.
Hey, thank you.
Or persistent enough like Old Gamma.
Thank you.
Or powerful enough, like the numbers boys, to break in.
No more breaking into my bank!
Help! Help!
Hey, wait a minute. What's wrong now?
Mr. President, another robbery!
Brother, somebody has broken in.
Must be a phantom bandit. A phantom bandit? Get the town marshal, get the army, the navy, call out the marines. He must be caught.
That is literature?
Well, it's...
The point we're trying to make, gentlemen, is that just a few inches of lead would shield any electroscope from all known radiations, even from the most powerful X-rays. But this new radiation, why, even lead walls 9 feet thick couldn't keep it from crashing through and collapsing the leaves. That meant that some unknown, super-powerful, ghostly radiation was loose in the world.
Where did this phantom come from?
The first guess was that it came from some new radioactive element in the Earth. But how to prove this? A Jesuit physicist, Theodore Wolff, thought he had a way. Father Wolff reasoned, if the phantom radiation came from the Earth, the higher you got in the air, the weaker it would be, and the slower it would discharge the leaves of an electroscope. In 1910, the good father went to the foot of the Eiffel Tower. He charged his electroscope and then carefully measured how long it took the unknown radiation to steal the charge from the leaves. And then he climbed and climbed and climbed, and at the top, 1,000 feet above the Earth, he recharged his electroscope. Now, if the unknown radiation came from the Earth, his electroscope should have discharged more slowly. But it didn't. If anything, it discharged faster.
Father Wolf didn't know it, but his legwork was the start of one of the greatest chases in the history of science.
Other investigators, including Victor Francis Hess, decided that the Eiffel Tower just wasn't high enough. So in 1912, Hess borrowed a balloon from the Austrian army. Then he rose past Father Wolf's 1,000 feet. Past 5,000, 10,000, 13, 14, 15,000 feet. There he charged his electroscope again, and he found that its leaves collapsed twice as fast as they did on the ground. At 3 miles up, the ghostly radiation, instead of becoming weaker, was twice as strong.
This really threw the science dicks for a loop. The phantom thief couldn't possibly come from the Earth. So where did he come from?
Gentlemen, gentlemen, please, we're on the air. All the networks. Who gets the Edgar?
We are not ready yet. Put on a commercial.
Go! Get out!
Yes, sir. Yes.
Your bandit is the sort of flying creature, then. A kind of atmospheric Batman?
That was the next guess, that the strange radiation originated somewhere in our own atmosphere. The argument was settled when a famous American scientist, Robert A. Millikan, took up the chase. Assisted by Ira Bowen, now director of the Palomar and Mount Wilson Observatories, Millikan built an electroscope that would time and record the discharge rate of the leaves and then charge them again automatically.
This is kind of an automatic mechanical bloodhound.
And Millikan's talkative bloodhounds, reporting back from balloons 50,000 feet above the plains of Texas, and from the deep waters of two California mountain lakes, proved beyond a doubt that the rays could not originate in our own atmosphere.
But where were the rays coming from then? The sun?
No.
Is bullets coming? It's easy. Mars.
No. The rays weren't coming from the sun, the moon, a planet, or any single star. Tell them why, Doc.
Well, because observers in every part of the world reported a most curious thing. The ghostly radiation was the same by night as by day, hitting each spot of the Earth continuously with equal force from every direction.
See, which meant they couldn't be coming from any single source. And so the amazed detectives were confronted with super, super rays whose hideout was the biggest ever imagined. The great open spaces of the entire universe.
Yes, and Millikan, recognizing the extraordinary nature of these rays, christened them cosmic rays.
It's becoming interesting.
What a pity. Real phantoms, and out where no one will ever see them.
Oh, one needn't see a criminal to know him, Charles. His dossier. Fingerprints, footprints, methods of operation, mental quirks often provide police with a more accurate picture than do the eyes.
A dossier on a ray?
That's exactly what the science detectives were trying to fill in. A dossier. Now, they'd already discovered the criminal's hideout. Merely the whole universe. All right, then. How about physical characteristics? Well, radiation can be either waves or particles. Were the rays waves, weightless energy like ordinary sunlight, or solid particles of matter, tiny atomic bullets?
To find the answer to that one, in 1929, two German science detectives, Walter Botha and Werner Kohlhorster, rigged up a sort of a cosmic mousetrap.
Mousetrap?
I'll give you a quick version of the heart, at least, of their famous experiment with this modern equipment.
You mean how they found out whether cosmic rays were solid particles or waves?
That's right.
This I gotta see.
Now, this is a bank of Geiger counters. The two Germans knew that when electromagnetic waves like X-rays, ultraviolet rays, or gamma rays, waves go through a Geiger counter, only about 1 in 50 of the waves going through could make the counter click.
1 in 50?
That's right. While solid particles of matter, electrons, for instance, would make the counter click every time one went through.
Particles outclick waves 50 to 1.
That's just in one counter. Well, by putting two banks of counters, one above the other like this, and wiring them so that waves of particles have to go through both counters before they can produce a click. They had the answer.
They did?
Well, figure it out. Waves with a 50-to-1 chance of causing a click in one counter, 50-to-1, have about a 2,500-to-1 chance if they have to actuate two counters before they produce the click.
Worse than a daily double.
While solid particles going through both counters, produce
a click each time one goes through. Okay, particles have it by 2,500-to-1. But where does the mousetrap part come in?
Oh, the mousetrap is this thick slab of lead that slipped in between the two counters. So, now this lead is thick enough to trap all stray earthly radiation and stop it from reaching the lower counters. But the hard-hitting cosmic rays go through it like a bullet through a cracker. I'll switch on the mousetrap, and you can determine for yourselves if the cosmic rays smashing down into this room right now are waves or particles. Now remember, occasional clicking, waves. Steady clicking, particles.
Particles.
Amazing.
Yes, particles. What you are hearing are actual cosmic ray bullets, the same bullets that crash into all of us.
First-rate detection.
And a second entry for the dossier. The invader from outer space is a particle.
These particles is like breadcrumbs, dandruff, or what?
No, something far more fundamental than dandruff. By particles, they meant the incredibly tiny bricks of matter that make up all atoms. Sealing wax, cabbages, kings. They're all built of three fundamental building blocks, the lightest of which is the electron with a negative charge. And about 2,000 times heavier is the proton with a positive charge. About the same weight as the proton is the neutron with no charge. Electron, proton, neutron.
But which of these trons was the criminal from outer space? That was the question.
With only three suspects, it should have been easy to pin down the culprit.
Quite easy, yes.
Might have been, if a complication hadn't arisen.
Ah, a complication. Good construction, Fedor.
What if you found out, Mr. Poe, that the particles discharging electroscopes and making these Geiger counters click were not the cosmic invaders from outer space at all?
What if you found out that they were the henchmen of the criminal?
Henchmen?
Well, maybe involuntary henchmen. They're really called secondaries. They're bits of air atoms shattered by the primary invaders as they crash into our atmosphere.
Which is the villain of your story? I assure you, readers have no such trouble identifying my villains. Take Fagin, for example, in Oliver Twist.
If you think of the character you're about to see as Fagin, maybe I can straighten you out. Look out, Tom. Now, there you see the Earth in its cloak of atmosphere. A constant rain of cosmic particles, millions and millions and millions of them every second, falls on the atmosphere. Now let's take one particle and follow it down in slow motion.
And that is Fagin?
That's right, that's Fagin. He's entering the Earth's atmosphere now. Those round things he's passing are air atoms. The closer you get to Earth, the more there are. Now he's bound to hit one pretty quick. Watch what happens when he does. There. Got a bad temper, Fagin has. See those little guys taking it on the lam? Those are the secondaries we were talking about. Dozens of them. Bits of air atoms kicked into violent action by a primary.
Ah, I see it now. The primary culprit from outer space is Fagin, and the secondaries from our own air are his henchmen. You see, Fedor?
I see nothing.
Oh.
Right. And another item for the dossier. Fagin's dossier. His M.O., method of operation, he works through henchmen.
This becomes interesting. A mastermind operating through pawns.
Well, hardly pawns, Mr. Poe. The henchmen themselves were soon found to be incredibly powerful, possessing enormous energy and speed.
Additional entries for the dossier?
Yeah, for the henchman's dossier. Because now the science detectives found they needed a second dossier. And where do you think they got their entries for the henchman's dossier? Well, it seems that the henchmen leave footprints.
Footprints?
And they were detected by a honey of a device, a cloud chamber.
Cloud chamber?
See here, Mr. Scientist. Are you trying to tell us that invisible cosmic criminals leave visible footprints?
That perhaps even we might see?
Yes. Sure you can.
Anybody can see them, right in his own kitchen. Soft lights, Doc. Any kid can make this kind of a two-bit cloud chamber. Look, first you take a piece of dry ice, then a large-mouthed jar. Set the jar on top of the dry ice. Now, it's well to put a piece of black cloth in the bottom of the jar so you can see the tracks better. Now, take a piece of cardboard and saturate it with alcohol. Any kind of alcohol will do. This that I'm using is just ordinary rubbing alcohol. Now, take a hot iron. Heat on top, cold on the bottom. Now you wait a few moments for the alcohol vapor to cool and settle. Now, let's flash a light through that. And there you are. Cosmic ray footprints. You can't see the actual flying particles, but you can see their tracks.
Much as invisible, high-flying jets leave their visible vapor trails, celestial footprints which reveal the jet's speed, height, and direction.
Incredible. Oh, I must do this trick for Tolstoy. It will kill him.
I can't wait to try it on Will Shakespeare.
Ah, but it's my trick.
Fascinating. But the vapor tracks all look alike. How could the detectives tell which henchman left which footprint?
Oh, yes, indeed, yes.
Good question, Mr. Poe. Whitestock. And the answer was simple but fascinating. A U-magnet. The kind kids pick up nails with.
As you probably know, Mr. Poe, between the poles of a magnet, there's a magnetic field as indicated by these lines of force. Now, the detectives knew that when a charged particle enters a magnetic field, its path is bent by the field and bent at right angles to the lines of force. Now, it's bent to the left if its charge is negative, and it's bent to the right if its charge is positive. Well, these scientific detectives reason, if they were to put a cloud chamber, this is a tiny model of a cloud chamber, in the middle of a very powerful magnetic field,
the footprints would curve.
Exactly, Mr. Poe. The cosmic ray henchman shooting through the cloud chamber would leave curved footprints. Then, by placing a camera here and photographing these cloud tracks, the detectives had an ingenious way of identifying the henchmen by analyzing their curved footprints.
This I like.
Now, for instance, as you'll see in these actual cloud chamber pictures, this particle had a negative charge because its track curves to the left. This track curves to the right, so its charge was positive.
These are pictures of the actual henchmen, aren't they?
Not of the particles themselves, but of their vapor trails, the footprints they leave behind in the cloud chamber as they're pulled to the right or to the left by the strong magnets outside the cloud chamber. When the detectives began photographing the henchmen's footprints in their elaborate cloud chambers, now equipped with an ingenious triggering system invented by PMS Blackett of England, GPS Occhialini of Italy, then measuring the amount of bending and the thickness of the tracks, they discovered some astounding things. The henchmen were traveling at unheard of speeds.
Speed? Wow.
Finally, from studies of thousands of cloud chamber photographs, the henchmen were identified.
And who do you think they turned out to be? Our old pals. Electron, proton, neutron. Those three building blocks of the universe.
Flying bricks of actual matter.
Just imagine, yes.
But remember, these energy-packed babies were only the henchmen. Think what superpower boss man Fagin himself must have.
But who was this master criminal?
Yes, who?
That was the brain twister. The sleuths had identified the gang, but not the leader. But since he operated way up high, an ocean of air lay between them and Fagin. How to get to him?
I'll give you 8 to 5, you'll never guess how they trapped him.
A woman, maybe?
Yeah, sort of a mother. To put the finger on Fagin, they used Mother Earth.
Now, just one procliata minuta.
Yes, Mr. Dostoevsky, they actually did use the Earth to find out if Fagin was armed, to find out if he carried an electric charge or was just a chunk of neutral matter. Lights, please. Now, this is a model of the Earth with its atmospheric shell. This is the vast magnetic field of the Earth. These wires represent the lines of magnetic force. Now, the Earth's field, like any other magnetic field, can bend the path of charged particles that move through it, but not of neutral particles. For instance, a neutral particle coming from outer space, this is the solid particle, this trailing tube's its track. Now, this neutral particle, having no charge, will shoot through to the Earth's atmosphere in a straight line, as if there were no magnetic field at all. So, if the space Fagins were neutral solid particles, they'd be unaffected by the magnetic field, and they'd crash into our atmospheric ocean equally all around the globe. And since each Fagin would create the same average number of henchmen, the resulting henchmen would rain down evenly over the whole Earth below.
Ah, yes. You see, if Fagin were neutral, the henchmen would rain down evenly over the whole Earth.
Eh. Charles, please. I have ears. I can hear.
Oh, I beg your pardon.
Now, let's see what happens if Fagin is charged.
Ah, yes. Let's see what happens if Fagin is charged, yes.
If the incoming particles were charged... Now, let's let these little red balls and red tubes represent the charged particles and their paths. If the particles coming in from outer space are charged particles, their paths would be bent by the field, as you can see by these few examples here. And the degree of bending is greatest where the particles come in at right angles to the lines of force, as they do here about the equator. As a result, and this is a key point, many of the particles coming in near the equator would have their paths bent so much that they'd miss the shell of the atmosphere completely. Look at this one, for instance, coming in at this angle, being so strongly, radically bent that it's gone out and hasn't come at all near our Earth's atmosphere. So too this one, coming in this direction and steaming out here again without ever getting near the atmosphere. While at the poles, charged particles would be bent very little, if at all, because they come in parallel to the lines of force. Look at these, how straight the paths are, compared to the curved paths of those nearer the equator. So, if the Fagins were charged, more of them would smash into our atmosphere at the poles than at the equator, kicking more henchmen into action beneath them at the poles than at the equator. And this so-called latitude effect could be measured by counting the number of collision pieces that rain down on us at various latitudes at the bottom of our air ocean. Lights, please.
Ah, the more henchmen below, the more Fagins above. Excellent reasoning.
The reasoning was simple compared to the legwork. For Operation Count the Henchmen, the cap and gown private eyes didn't just cover one street, one city, one county. They blanketed the whole globe, from pole to pole, from the halls of Montezuma to the shores of Tripoli. Sifted and evaluated, the data from this global legwork, not counting the professorial bunions, plainly showed that for every 100 henchmen particles hitting the Earth at the poles, only 87 struck at the equator. Now, that meant there were more Fagans at the poles than at the equator. There was a latitude effect.
And that could only mean that at least some of the space invaders were charged.
The detectives were closing in. The master crook was armed with an electric charge.
That means Fagan couldn't be a neutron.
Right, Mr. Poe. A neutron has no charge.
Then he must be a proton or an electron.
100 rubles says Fagan is a proton.
Covered with 2 pounds, my friend. I say he's an electron.
3 pounds. Takes 3 pounds.
Two, Theodore, two.
Well, we'll soon know. Now, Dr. Research, was Fagan's charge positive or negative?
Yes, yes.
And wait till you hear how the learned Hawkshaw solved that problem. And with the Earth again. Go ahead, Doc.
Let's turn over our globe and its magnetic field so that we're looking down on the South Pole. Now we already know that an incoming particle with a positive charge would be bent to the right by the magnetic field, or to the left if it had a negative charge. Well then, an Italian physicist, Bruno Rossi, reasoned that if the cosmic rays were positive, the Earth's magnetic field would cause a majority of them to strike from the west, smashing more henchmen into us from the west. While if they were negative, a majority would strike us from the east.
And bingo, the missing clue came in from Mexico.
Yes, where 3 investigators, Arthur Compton, T.H. Johnson, and Luis Alvarez, reported conclusively more henchmen came in from the west. That could only mean at least some of the cosmic invaders carried a positive charge.
Fagan's charge was positive. Mystery's clearing up, huh?
Clearing up is like daylight is mystery for children.
Of course, your story's over.
Of your 3 fundamental building blocks, electron, proton, neutron, only one was positive.
Please, let me crush these, excuse the expression, storytellers. Now, you got neutron, no charge. Electron, negative. Proton, positive. So, Fagan is proton. Give me the money.
Not so fast there, Fedor.
Why not?
Wait a minute. Show him the positron still, Doc.
Positron stills?
Now, this is a photograph of a cosmic ray track taken in a cloud chamber on the 2nd of August, 1932, by Professor Carl Anderson at Caltech. Now, the light curved track seems to match the footprint of an electron, but instead of curving to the left in the cloud chamber's magnetic field, as a respectable electron should, this strange particle curved to the right.
Is Umpty Dumpty photograph, maybe, upside down?
That's one of the most famous photographs in science, Dosti. Got Anderson a Nobel Prize.
The first picture of the tracks of a hitherto unknown particle of matter, a positive electron.
A particle. Positively charged. Why couldn't that be Fagan, Dosti, instead of your proton?
I move we reject the entry.
Second emotion.
Third.
Why, Mr. Poe?
By introducing a new suspect at this late date, you have violated a cardinal rule of the detective story.
Yeah, is cheating, is my money.
But think of the impact of this discovery, Edgar. Why, it's as if your Detective Dupin, searching for a human criminal, ran across an unknown species of man. It's astounding.
Is cheating.
A brand new kind of matter has been discovered.
Yes.
And a 4th henchman for Fagan. The positron.
Bah! What difference? Positron, proton, Pimpleton. This is useful. Is big doings about little nothings.
Now, wait a minute, Dosti. Out of little nothings like this have come the big doings of science. Newton wondering why an apple hits his head. Out of that came the law of gravitation. Rentgen, in trying to figure out why his photographic plates got fogged, came up with X-rays. Maxwell, tinkering with some tricky equations, came up with a key to television.
And this chase after little particles is the key for something big?
Just about the biggest something man ever ran into, Mr. Dostoevsky. Nuclear force.
Nuclear force?
That's big.
nuclear force. We've heard rumors about that.
Exactly what is meant by force?
That's a large order, Mr. Poe. If I could answer that, I'd be 10 Einsteins rolled in one. But in general, by force, science means a strange, almost mystic quality or power possessed by matter. It manifests itself in three ways: gravitational force, electromagnetic force, and nuclear force.
Oh, yes, you see, there are three, yes.
Now, in a sense, a force can be likened to an army. Force exerts its power through individual units, just as an army does through its individual units, or soldiers. With gravity, the force that holds the whirling planets in their orbits, the smallest individual unit, the soldier that does this planet holding, is said by some scientists to be the graviton, although this graviton has never been pinned down or observed in any way. Now, if we focus down to just one atom, not large bodies, but just one atom, helium, for instance, another force takes over. Electromagnetic force. Now, this second force keeps the atomic solar system from flying apart.
And the electromagnetic soldier?
That's called the photon. And unlike the graviton, this photon has been measured and directly observed. Now, if we go deep into the heart of the atom, into its nucleus, we come to the third and most sensational force. Nuclear force. That's the force that holds the protons and neutrons locked in the tiny nucleus. The awesome force man is now unlocking for his own use. The force which will surely change the way of life for every man, woman, and child on Earth.
And the soldier?
The soldier that does the holding of nuclear force? That, dramatically enough, came out of the cosmic ray chase, out of tracking down Fagin's henchmen.
Here's the way it happened. And boy, this really rocked the science world. In Japan in 1935, at Osaka University, a genius named Hideki Yukawa sat alone with a pencil and a piece of paper, and he came up with a most amazing prediction. He said that the soldier, the unit of this terrific new force, would appear, believe it or not, as a small particle, a piece of actual matter. He calculated it would be about 200 times heavier than the electron, and get this, would live about a millionth of a second, then poof, it would disappear, die. Well, this was just too deep even for the highbrows. Yukawa's prediction dropped like a feather in the scientific pond. But meanwhile, the cosmic ray chase was still going on. Since the discovery of the positron, the scientific working stiffs were photographing cloud chamber tracks around the clock to see if there were more new particles among Fagin's henchmen. Well, up popped the devil. Seth Nedemeyer and Carl Anderson of Caltech and J.C. Street and E.C. Stevenson of Harvard all came up with a new track at about the same time.
What is it?
A real oddball. The track of a particle more than 200 times heavier than an electron, and which, if you please, lives only a millionth of a second or so.
Yukawa's prediction. His nuclear soldier.
Why, of course.
No, doggone it.
Oh?
This strange new particle, called a mu meson, just didn't behave as Yukawa said it should. It wasn't quite the nuclear soldier he'd predicted.
There was a bit of disappointment on Yukawa's prophetic face. But there was no disappointment in the particle department. The bug-eyed cosmic ray detectives realized that they'd stumbled onto another brand new piece of matter that no one ever dreamed existed. And another henchman for Fagin's rogues gallery, the mu meson.
And then some 10 years later came the happy ending, happy for the Japanese wizard. It came from the developing tanks of a laboratory in the University of Bristol, England. On photographic plates exposed on the tops of the Bolivian Andes and the French Pyrenees, three astonished cosmic ray hunters, an Englishman, C.F. Powell, an Italian, G.P.S. Occhialini, and a Brazilian, C.M. Lattice, ran across the track of a quite similar but heavier meson.
Eureka! This was it. This soldier did obey orders.
This newer particle, it's called a pi meson, did seem to fit Yukawa's equations. His amazing prediction came true, and he was awarded a Nobel Prize for it. Now, Mr. Poe, I think I can answer your question. Most people believe that the unit of nuclear force, the tremendously powerful soldier that holds the heart of the atom together, is the Pi Mason.
Pi Mason,
yes.
And a sixth Fagin henchman got his name on the police blotter. The Pi Mason.
But weren't the detectives a bit confused by all these odd henchmen of Fagin's?
Yes, I should think they would be, yes.
Confused? They were bewitched, bothered, and bewildered.
Yes, and they still are. Think of it. As late as 1932, science had the universe all neatly wrapped up in three little basic packages: electron, proton, neutron. Just 25 years later, in 1957, the number of separate and distinct particles of matter had jumped to at least 20.
Including two really out-of-this-world babies. The neutrino, a kind of ghost particle that leaves no footprints, yet apparently zips through lead as if it were butter. And the newly discovered antiproton, which some people think is one of the building blocks of an unseen world, a sort of left-handed world of matter matching the right-handed world we live in.
Yes, not to mention K-mesons, tau-mesons, hyperons, V-particles.
A veritable deluge.
And no one knows how many more henchmen are going to show up or what they're going to mean. Scientists are crying for a Moses to lead them out of the wilderness of nuclear particles.
I says proton.
Yes, yes. Well, what about the detective story? What about Fagin?
Oh, yes, yes.
Oh, they nailed Fagin, all right. To do it, they went right up through the air ocean and took his picture.
His picture?
Well, perhaps impression is a better word.
Okay, Doc. Impression. With this new detection gadget, it's a cosmic ray emulsion plate. It's very much like an ordinary photographic plate, only it's more sensitive, and it's got a much thicker coating of silver bromide. Now, the aim of the science detectives was to get a flash of old Fagin on here before he smashed into our air atoms. Well, obviously, that meant going very high indeed, way up almost to the top of our atmosphere, where the population of air atoms is very scarce. With these lightweight plates and a new kind of balloon named the Skyhook, they did the trick.
Skyhooks quite easily carry instruments up to 140,000 feet or more and can stay up there for several days.
During which time, police switchboards buzz with flying saucer reports.
Ah, but it's with rockets that we really take instruments up into Fagin's home territory. Up to 150 miles, up to where the emulsion plate is face to face with Fagin himself. From dozens of rocket flights. From literally hundreds of balloon launchings all over the world. Picture of the master criminal began to emerge after a king-sized chase of over 50 years. Here's what Fagin looks like, or rather what his trail looks like, as he smashes through the silver bromide on the photographic plate.
And this is what happens when Fagin hits one of the silver atoms square on the nucleus. Weight for weight, he's got the biggest sock in the universe. The first to actually mug Fagin were some Chicago detectives.
Yes, a group of physicists headed by Marcel Schein. From microscopic examinations of the tracks left in their emulsions, they announced that most of the Fagins, the primary rays from outer space, were protons, naked hydrogen atoms stripped of their electrons.
Protons! I was right! Give me the money!
No, Fader, yes, not
Charles,
so fast!
I win
order,
the money,
you have won nothing! Yes. Order, General!
Yes, I'll ask him! Doctor, search me! I was right, no?
Only partially right, Mr. Dostoevsky. In 1948, physicists from the universities of Minnesota and Rochester found other primary tracks, too heavy, too highly charged to be protons. And the most numerous of these were made by naked helium atoms. And in addition, the tracks of still heavier atoms were found. In other words, the Fagins are really atoms, common familiar atoms, stripped of their electrons and hurtling through space at unholy speeds. Atomic bullets from beyond the beyond, crashing into us with almost the speed of light.
And when he says crash, he means crash. These cosmic ray babies crack into us with energies of more than 1,000,000,000 electron volts. More than 5,000,000 times as strong as an A-bomb atom. That's our space boy, Fagin. And his identity? Naked Atom.
Amazing. Absolutely amazing.
My money.
But no more amazing than the detectives who tracked him down.
Do you mean to say they actually know where he comes from?
Well, they've got one pretty good idea. Tell them about it, Doc.
Well, many scientists now think the cosmic Fagins are being spawned continuously in our own galaxy, the Milky Way. They believe that all stars, including our own sun, are constantly casting off particles into space through surface explosions, and that these cast-off star particles, zillions and zillions of them, gradually acquire their cosmic speeds and energies by being bounced back and forth between galactic clouds.
Galactic clouds?
Yes. Our own Milky Way, which looks something like our neighboring galaxy, Andromeda, contains not only billions of stars that spiral around, but also millions of truly enormous galactic clouds composed of dust and gas. These galactic clouds float and swirl through the Milky Way in all directions. Sometimes they look black and they obscure the stars behind them. These swirling clouds apparently create gigantic magnetic fields. The late Enrico Fermi, one of the great pioneers of modern science, Fermi suggested that within our Milky Way, gargantuan badminton games go on, in which the players are these huge magnetic fields, and the birds are tiny naked atoms which have been shot into space from erupting stars. And the atoms are naked because the star heat is so intense that atoms can't hang on to their satellite electrons as they do at normal temperatures.
What the...
When such an atom is exploded into space from a star, it will eventually collide with a magnetic field and bounce off. It will bounce off with more speed if the field is moving toward it. Years later, it runs into another gigantic field and is sent shooting off in another direction. And after 1,000,000 years or so of this being batted back and forth, these atoms, they're our Fagins, and remember their numbers countless, are kicked up to almost the speed of light and sent hurtling through our Milky Way in all directions. And the tiny dot, which is our Earth, moving through space, sails through this myriad of shooting particles, and a tiny fraction of them crash into us as cosmic rays.
Gentlemen, do you realize what this means? The Fagins bombarding us from outer space are pieces of matter from billions of stars. And since these space bullets are the same atomic particles we have on Earth, that means the stars are made of the same stuff we're made of. A part of the eggs you had for breakfast this morning could have come from Orion. Or from the Big Dipper. And some of the carbon in this young lady's shining red hair might once upon a time have been stardust from an exploded supernova. Or from the Southern Cross. Why, you could almost say that in tracking down Fagin, the science detectives uncovered material proof of the oneness of the whole great cosmos.
Mr. Scientist, for highbrows, this could be exciting. Maybe. But what is meaning for common people who work, love, hate?
Yes. What is the meaning for ordinary mortals?
Oh, a very big meaning indeed, Mr. Dostoevsky. It's possible that how people work, love, hate, has been and is even now being affected by cosmic rays. It's possible that in the millions and billions of years they've been bombarding the Earth, these cosmic space bullets could be partly responsible for evolution by causing mutations, sudden changes, as they smash into our reproductive genes.
My word.
Why, Dusty, It's conceivable that your enormous writing talent could be traced to some well-directed cosmic ray hitting your great-grandfather in just the right gene.
My writing? Cosmic rays?
Do you realize what this would mean philosophically, Edgar? The changes in living things may be controlled by the stars.
And still more significant, Mr. Dickens.
Yes?
Someday, out of the strange case of the cosmic rays, out of this out-of-the-world detective story, may come the answer to the great riddle of what makes the universe tick.
Well, gentlemen, how about it? Do we get the Edgar?
Charles.
Yes, yes.
I make my vote now.
Yeah, I know. Yet.
No, no, not yet. Science is for people. I thought it was just for long hairs. I vote da. Yes.
You do?
Yes. A truly remarkable story.
Hey, Doc, did you hear that?
But an epic adventure of the human spirit, the mind of man, daring to explore the unknown reaches of the heavens just to track down these tiny particles of stardust, so packed with primeval power, they come winging with the speed of light. Celestial messengers from out where the morning stars sing together.
Good line, Charles. Excellent poetry.
What is the message they bring, and why?
Huh?
What?
Gentlemen, we thank you for a saga of brilliant scientific accomplishment. But as a detective story, and that's what we're judging, as a detective story, your tale has a fundamental weakness. Motive.
Motive!
Fedor, they've established no motive for their cosmic Fagans.
But Edgar...
Why do they bombard the Earth?
Edgar, if they knew motive for cosmic rays, they'd have answer to great mystery of creation itself. I vote yes.
I vote no. Their story's unfinished.
Charles, you vote yes. No?
You know, I'm reminded of Isaac Newton.
He's reminded. It's a good story. Give him
just a moment, Fedor. Just a moment, Fedor. I haven't finished. I'm reminded of Isaac Newton, perhaps the greatest scientific mind that ever lived, and how he humbly described his monumental discoveries as now and then finding a smoother pebble or a prettier shell while the great ocean of truth lay before me. That great ocean of truth still lies undiscovered before you.
Briefly, Charles, how do you vote?
I vote we invite these gentlemen to come back in 50 years to tell us what new chapters they've added to their cosmic tale.
Ah, excellent, Charles.
Thank you.
Most excellent.
Thank you. And who will write these new chapters? The young. The inheritors of all the knowledge and culture of the ages. Of all the dreams and hopes of those who went before us. What an exciting time to be young.
Yes, and what a glorious opportunity to add to man's history, to harness these nuclear fires for man's use, to accept the challenge of creation, and to use the gifts God gave us to explore the grandest of all frontiers, the universe. For the more we know of creation, the closer we get to the Creator.
Three cheers for Stardust.
The Bell Telephone System takes pride in bringing you this program in its series of shows on science. We wish to express our gratitude to the distinguished Board of Advisors who guide the choice and treatment of scientific matter for the series. Biology and genetics, medicine, bacteriology and botany, chemistry, geophysics, physics, anthropology, mathematics, engineering. For the program you have just seen, our thanks to the special advisors who have suggested and checked the scientific material. The Bell Telephone System is indebted to all these men and to many institutions for the generous support they have given this venture in public education through entertainment.
Well, there you have it. A strange case of the cosmic rays. Let me shut off the DVD. That's the second in our double feature of Bell Science series shows tonight. We were joined by a new viewer on Mixer named Fenris Strange. I like the name. It's an interesting name. He says, that was cool. It's time for that update film. Yes, we're overdue to submit the Strange Case of the Cosmic Rays once again to the mystery contest to be judged there by Edgar Allan Poe and Dostoevsky and Charles Dickens. I'm afraid the picture of the particles that make up the universe would still be a mess even today. They have not reached the secret of the universe. I was disappointed that every time I watch these, I'm reminded of how much religious language there is when these shows wrap up. I was disappointed that Dr. Research himself was the one talking about studying creation, become closer to the Creator. It's too bad. But again, this was shown on network television in the mid-1950s. Kind of, I'm sure they were somewhat forced into it. Anyway, how much did you like the puppets there, the Edgar Allan Poe puppets and the Dostoevsky? Great fun. Not as entertaining a film as the first one, The Our Mr. Sun, I thought, anyway. But still, I mean, this is how educational films should be. This is how the really, really reaching the full potential of educational film here. If you've not, if you don't own copies of these, go online and find them to watch through them again. Our Mr. Sun and Strange Case of the Cosmic Rays. Frank Capra directed two others in this series: Hemo the Magnificent, about the bloodstream, and Unchained Goddess, about weather, about the study of weather and climate. And in Unchained Goddess, remember this was released in 1957, in Unchained Goddess, and listen to what I'm about to say here, in Unchained Goddess in 1957, I'm really building up to this because it's a point that I'm going to make. Larry says, I love the Baird puppets. Yeah, they're great puppets, aren't they? James says, I liked it. Some of the greatest scientists in history were devout Christians. Speaking of scientists, did you notice that Fenris says school would have been very much more fun? Yes. Did you notice that these films, both of these films, they credited every scientist whose work they mentioned? Did you notice that Dr. Research, whenever he would talk about research that was going on, or research that had recently been done, they would cut to a film of the scientist that he was talking about, and he would mention them by name. And in the credits of the second one, in the credits of Strange Case of the Cosmic Rays, they spent much of the credits of the film listing the scientists that had worked on the film. They did the same thing with Our Mr. Sun, but for some reason with this particular copy, the end credits were missing. Have you ever seen any films, any science films even, give that much credit to the actual scientists whose work they were discussing? Anyway, in Unchained Goddess, and you should go online and see it, it's not the best of the film. I think of the four that Frank Capra produced, I think Unchained Goddess is the least entertaining. However, in Unchained Goddess in 1957, and listen carefully to what I'm about to say, in Unchained Goddess in 1957, Dr. Research pointed out that the Earth's atmosphere was getting warmer because of human activity. I want to repeat what I just said. In Unchained Goddess, produced by Frank Capra in 1957, Dr. Research, Dr. Frank Baxter of University of Southern California, pointed out and warned that the Earth's atmosphere was getting warmer due to human activity. Do you realize the importance of that? Global warming was a known phenomenon. It always has been. Anyway, moving on. If you've not seen those films, and if you've never seen... I didn't show Hemo the Magnificent because it's about the bloodstream, and there's a lot of footage of blood. A lot of footage of surgery, open-heart surgery, and it's something that some people could find really unpleasant. But I think Hemo the Magnificent is the best of the four films, and I really think it's unfortunate that I couldn't show it tonight. And I really did feel that I could not show it because of the blood content in it. Anyway, thank you everyone for watching. Thank you for our new viewers. Fenris, please give us a follow. Margie Blast, The Greenhouse Effect. Yes, global warming. Dr. Research was telling people on television about it 60 years ago. Margie, I'm glad you're still here. Let's figure out, you're wanting to make a donation. Let's figure out how you can do that. For those of you who came in, you see below my face here our donation goal. We've had $40 in new donations tonight, so we're at $136. Thank you for following, Fenris. I'm glad you were listening, and you followed. I have a streaming on Mixer, just because we had a Mixer account. I thought we might as well stream to it. I found that Twitch is our most reliable source. If you're also a user of Twitch, please follow us on Twitch, because Twitch is very good about informing people when we stream, and it's been very stable for us. Margie, if you're wanting to make a donation, you were saying the link in the on the Facebook thing was too difficult. The Streamlabs link was too difficult for you. Did you see the link? Did you see the email address that I posted? The PayPal email address that I posted. If you can donate directly by PayPal to the address donation@50th.st. Do you use Venmo? Do you use Cash App? Because we have addresses for those as well. But yeah, we do need the donations. We made $40 more dollars tonight, so we're technically at 136. And I wanted to get to 300 tonight. Now that we're at the end of the show, it doesn't look like we can make that. But anyone who is able to donate, please do so. 50th Street is a nonprofit. We opened up a retail space here in Renton, Washington, just outside of Seattle. And we were having people in here every weekend seeing live movies on our big 75-inch TV. We were having great fun. We were raising donations on every Saturday and Sunday. We were having an artist bazaar. People were coming in, buying stuff from the artists. We were getting donations. Things were working. Things were going well. And then the virus happened. So here I am in basically locked up in a bunker alone, streaming. Margie has PayPal, so you'll work on it. Okay. Please contact me. Please message me on Facebook or whatever if you're having trouble, and we'll get that worked out. And I appreciate the fact that you're wanting to donate. For those of you who don't know, Margie is a friend of ours who came to some of our movies. She came to Night of the Living Dead. She came to Gamera. And Margie, I looked at your Facebook page, and I saw the little tribute you had written to about your late brother. It was very touching, and I'm glad we met you. I'm glad you came back. And is Miranda still here? Is Miranda still watching? Miranda has been probably our biggest, most frequent supporter here at the new location, here at the Renton location. And Larry, of course. I hope Larry is still watching. I'm sorry you had to miss the last half of Our Mr. Sun there, Larry, because that's a great film. When you came back in time to see the last half of The Strange Case of the Cosmic Rays, you must have been somewhat confused. But how about those? How about that Dostoevsky puppet? I think you missed the line. I think you came in too late where Dostoevsky said, Miranda's here. Thank you for being here, Miranda. Thank you for the donation. I think, Larry, you missed the line where the Dostoevsky puppet said, He said, I can't wait to show that trick to Trotsky. It will kill him. Which I thought was hilarious. Very creative stuff, very inventive stuff. You should be able to find the Bell Science series, all of them, online somewhere, probably YouTube. If not, look at archive.org. The only ones that I've seen other than these four, the ones that were not, Fenris says hello to everybody else. Hope all is well. Thank you again for joining us and following us, Fenris. Tell your friends about these Saturday shows. Next Saturday, speaking of which, next Saturday, everyone who's watching, please listen. Next Saturday at 7 p.m. Pacific, that's 10 p.m. Eastern, but at 7 p.m. Pacific, I'll be showing a marathon of Betty Boop and Popeye cartoons. That's what we'll be watching. And I'm really looking forward to it. That's going to be great fun. I'll be, Margie says, thank you. Don't worry, I'm going to be around. Puppets reminding me of the old Thunderbirds. The Thunderbirds were definitely marionettes. I may have to show some of the Thunderbirds films sometime. My favorite of the Gary and Sylvia, what's the name of the they're called Super Marionation. Gary and Sylvia, what were their names? The people who produced those. But my favorite Super Marionation show was Captain Scarlet. That was always my favorite. They were the most human looking, with the most human proportions, and you would have to do a double take. I didn't grow up with Thunderbirds. I was a little too young for that. I grew up with Space 1999, which was produced by the same people, if you didn't know. What else is there to talk about? Thank you everyone for watching. Please support 50th Street. Tell your friends. Please have your friends follow, because next week we're going to be doing Betty Boop and Popeye. On Tuesday at 4 p.m. Pacific, on Tuesday, that'll be 7 p.m. Eastern, I'll be streaming live. It'll be a talk show. I'll be going through the memorabilia we have here in the studio. I still have some more boxes to unbox. I know Miranda really likes the unboxings. I think Miranda was our only watcher last Tuesday. Hopefully I'll have a guest of some sort, a live guest of some sort. I'm trying to have to show live guests. And Larry, if you're still here, while you were gone, I showed people this photograph of Dr. Bunsen Honeydew, and I'm theorizing that that Dr. Frank Baxter, known as Dr. Research here, was the inspiration for the Muppet Dr. Bunsen Honeydew. I can't unsee it once I thought of it myself. Yeah, I think it has to be true. I think it's got to be true. Please follow our Discord. There is a Discord for 50th Street. Miranda says we need more viewers for Tuesday for sure. Yes, we do. We have a Discord, which is a good way to follow us and a good way to chat with me. We do have a Twitter. Fenris says, lol, love Muppets. Yeah. But we will definitely be doing Betty Boop and Popeye. For those of you who did not know, Popeye made his first animated appearance in a Betty Boop cartoon. Betty Boop actually introduced Popeye. He, of course, originated from the newspaper comics by E.C. Seeger, but his first time appearing in an animated cartoon was in a Betty Boop cartoon, and it followed the same formula that all the Popeye cartoons follow. Betty Boop and Olive Oil were at the county fair. Bluto started making trouble. Popeye eats a can of spinach and kicks ass. They established the formula with the very first cartoon, and it was a Betty Boop cartoon. But we'll see you next week for that, and we'll show you the origins of not only Popeye, but the origins of Betty Boop, and you'll be surprised. What else is there to talk about? Does anyone else have questions? Fenris says, I remember that one. Does anyone have questions for me? Would anyone like me to answer questions about 50th Street? 50th Street, again, is a nonprofit. Our intention is to ultimately, one day, become a... Margie says, will you be showing that one, please? Yes, the first Popeye cartoon, yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we'll be showing that one. Betty Boop is at the county fair, and she's doing a hula dance, a grass skirt hula dance, and Popeye likes it so much he gets on stage and dances with her. And then Bluto shows up, and then Popeye kicks his ass, and that's the end of it. Yeah, we'll be showing that. We'll be showing you the first Betty Boop cartoon, which is weird. I've shown the first Betty Boop cartoons before. Have I shown it? No, I haven't live streamed it. I showed it to some kids. Anyway, follow us on our Discord, those of you who can. Look for 50th Street Studio on Discord. I think you have to have an invitation to join a Discord. Anyway, whatever. Discord is the best way to follow everything that I'm doing and to chat with me. Twitter, we don't have enough followers on Twitter. Look for 50th Street Studio on Twitter. I look at the Twitter every day. It's an okay way to communicate with me. Facebook is too chaotic. I post everything on Facebook, but it's too hard to follow. Same with Instagram. We do have an Instagram. It's too hard to communicate with me on Instagram. I'm sticking to Discord and Twitter and the live streams and Twitch. I'm happy with Twitch. Thanks again for our new viewers. Thanks for coming, Fenris, and thanks for following. Did you just find us at random, Fenris? Is that how you found us? I'm actually hoping that you did, because that would be the second follower we've gotten on Mixer from just a random find. I had great fun watching these again. Maybe we'll repeat these someday. The next Saturday is the last, he says, yeah. Next Saturday is the last scheduled film that I've posted. Because after the virus happened, it seemed kind of pointless to keep scheduling films. And I think I may start repeating our most popular things. I think I may show Turkish Star Wars. Would everybody like to see Turkish Star Wars again? That was great fun. For those of you who have not seen it, you will fall in love with Turkish Star Wars. And we may get more viewers from that. And I may show Night of the Living Dead again. We have to figure out how to get viewers to these, though. I want hundreds of people to be watching these. I may try to get Skip Elsheimer from AV Geeks to help us promote these. I may try to get him as a guest. You should follow AV Geeks on YouTube. Miranda says, I enjoyed these, and when the quarantine is lifted, I want to see the blood one. Oh, the Hemo the Magnificent? Yeah. Hemo the Magnificent. Hemo the Magnificent is the best of the films, if you ask me. It's the most entertaining, the most interesting. Because Hemo is a character like our Mr. Sun. He argues with the scientists. Miranda says yes to Turkish Star Wars. You remember how much fun that was, watching that with a room full of people? How did we get so many people to see Turkish Star Wars? I don't know. I don't know where they all came from. Yeah, you remember all the laughing? Yeah. And remember me warning people that halfway through the film, I was telling people, hey, this guy hasn't even got started. This guy's only just getting ready to kick ass. Yeah, we'll definitely show Turkish Star Wars. And what are some of our most... Night of the Living Dead was our most popular. We had even more people than in Turkish Star Wars. But it's not the kind of thing that I want to live stream. I want to live stream stuff that's hilarious. Miranda says, I flyered the city for the first time that month. Yeah. But I'm not sure. I'm not sure how, why people showed up. I never know why. I know why people showed up for Night of the Living Dead. It's because that was the first time that Crypticon helped us promote the stream. I don't need this in my ear anymore. I need my microphone, though. And that was because Crypticon helped us promote that. I'm not sure what it was with Turkish Star Wars. Maybe just because I talked it up so much. Maybe you talked it up so much. Somehow people were finding it on Facebook. Maybe, I don't, I didn't know the people who came. Most of the people who showed up, I didn't even know. So they were finding it somehow. At that point, we had been here for weeks. We had been here for a couple of months. And every time people came in, I would talk to them about Turkish Star Wars. Maybe that's why it was happening. But we definitely need to show that again. And unfortunately, I don't know if the quarantine is going to be lifted. I think our state governments have gone insane. And unfortunately, it's created real hysteria with people. So I think, honestly, I think all of these small businesses all over town, all over the city, all over the state, I think are just doomed. I think everyone's going to go out of business, including us. As much as I hate to say it, I don't think this is going to have a happy ending. On that note, I hate to go on a sad note, but unless anyone else has any more questions, and unless there's any more donations to be made, please make donations, by the way. Those of you who are new, I appreciate the donations we've gotten tonight, but it's not nearly enough. We need hundreds of viewers every week, and we need hundreds of dollars in donations every week if we're going to survive. I know it's tough. It's scary. Larry says, thanks as always, Keith. Well, thank you for being here, Larry. And go back and watch these films and see the parts that you missed, because these are very much worth it. Great films that people have forgotten about. And I was actually somewhat surprised that you had never heard of these, Larry, because they're such a unique part of animation history, with Seamus Culhane doing the animation for both of these particular films. There were UPA did animation for some of the others. Disney actually did animation for some of the later ones that were not produced by Capra. Warner Brothers produced some films later on in the series. I think they were directed by Jack Warner himself, and they're not good. But if you're interested in the history of it, they're worth seeing. They had names like the Great Alphabet Conspiracy, and the something. I've forgotten already, because I haven't paid that much attention to them. Hans Conried was in The Great Alphabet Conspiracy. Was that Hans Conried, or am I thinking of... it was Hans Conried. Unfortunately, every once in a while I'll get him confused with... another name I'm forgetting. Well, whatever. I'm getting sleepy. My head is dropping. It's almost 10 p.m. here. I need to actually get something to eat and get to bed. I haven't had a meal all day. But thank you, everyone, for coming. I'm going to go ahead and end it. Thank you for watching. Thank you for your donations. Margie, contact me tomorrow, and we'll get that donation straightened out. And everyone else, please put us on your schedules for next week, and we'll watch Betty Boop and Popeye. And on Tuesday, we'll be live streaming. Fenris says, thank you, 50th. Thank you, Fenris, for following. I'm glad we have a new fan. And good night.